Welcome back to The Point. Earlier this afternoon, the BJP released its charge sheet against the UPA. As you know, it's easy to accuse, and after 10 years, no government is without faults. But has the BJP built up a telling case? Or are they blind to the UPA's real achievements, whilst of course forgetting their own damaging lapses? My guests are Congress MP Renuka Chaudhary, BJP Deputy Leader of Opposition in the Rajya Sabha, Ravi Shankar Prasad, the Associate Editor of the Business Standard, Mihir Sharma, and one of India's most highly regarded sociologists, Shiv Vishwanathan. Renuka Chaudhary, let's start with the conclusion of the BJP charge sheet against your government. The Congress-led UPA government has indeed been a disaster for this country, it says. It has only left a legacy of suffering, agony, disappointment and hopelessness for the people of India. And I should point out that the polls seem to suggest most people agree. What's your response to that conclusion?
I don't know what kind of poll surveys are done by you all, because we know that it all depends on the questions that are asked.
But and I'm not talking actually about a poll.
Forget,
I'm talking about the BJP. The BJP says you've left a legacy of suffering, agony, disappointment and hopelessness.
I think the BJP is stuck in a Nirupa Roy syndrome. Let me tell you, the BJP has a convenient recall amnesia, as it's called in psychological terms. They have forgotten that it was the UPA government that has had the most fantastic international relations, when the whole world was actually sinking. India was buoyant. We never went into anywhere near negative growth. Yes, we slid a little, we have put the brakes on, and the economy is going forward.
Okay.
There is already a change at the ground level, as it can be seen. And they have forgotten that employment has risen. The fact of the matter is that for the first time ever, we are first amongst equals everywhere.
All right.
The BJP doesn't want to remember this.
All right.
They don't want to recall this because they sell.
Let me
untruths.
Let me come to others to get some sense of independent valuation, and then I'll come back to you and go into the actual specifics of the charge sheet against you. Shiv Vishwanathan, there's no doubt that the economy has slowed down. But we also, side by side, have had a right to education, a right to information, and NREGA. And then side by side, we've also experienced massive scams and a weak prime minister. When you add all of that up together, does it prove or disprove the BJP's conclusion?
See, if you're going to do an act of poetic mathematics, this is poor. Because actually, the way they list it out, Congress almost becomes an epic narrative. I think they don't see contradictions. They don't see silences. Let me just point out one thing. If you look at it, there's been a tremendous amount of social experimentation, a tremendous relation to civil society in terms of a social imagination. Maybe it didn't work, but to sort of load it one way makes this narrative sound a bit unfair.
So what you're saying, and I'm decoding you for the audience, is actually credit is not being given to the Congress for a lot of imaginative things that they tried, even if those things didn't work.
And the list could be more nuanced.
There's a wonderful phrase that he used, poetic mathematics. For the life of me, I don't know whether that makes sense or whether, in fact, it's a contradiction. But let me come to what people would call the brass tacks with you. The polls suggest that Congress is heading towards its worst ever defeat. Congress MPs and ministers, even in private, are prepared to accept they're going to lose, some say lose badly. Do those two facts suggest that the BJP conclusion is correct? Or is this just the anti-incumbency you would expect after 10 years, and very similar to what the BJP experienced themselves in 2004?
Well, I think that for the past many years, we've heard a lot of pro-reform people, I suppose myself included, making the following point, that if you deliver income growth, if you deliver better standards of living, then you get re-elected. And unfortunately, we may have to rethink if the Congress is in fact voted out spectacularly, because whatever else the Congress may have done wrong, they certainly have delivered vast increases in the standard of living over the past 10 years. They've increased disposable income by 20% a year. Every year.
It's very interesting. You're talking in terms that are similar but more concrete to Shiv Vishwanathan. You're saying there's a lot of good the Congress did. The economy has grown in substantial terms. The paradox is the country isn't in a mood to give the Congress the benefit for that. The country, much like the BJP, can only see the lapses and the mistakes, not the achievements. Is that right?
Well, I think if anything, that's the Congress's own fault. The Congress party has chosen over the past year and a half, and possibly longer than that, to run away from everything that the United Progressive Alliance may or may not have done. And this is the final sort of the last stab of the dual power center, as it were, when it's like, okay, let's see if we can blame Manmohan Singh for everything that the UPA has done, and the Gandhis will be unaffected.
Very quickly before I go to Ravi Shankar Prasad, there's a hint in what Mihir Sharma is saying, that if Congress had better communicated, better advertised what they've achieved, as well as the things that they attempted, which were noble experiments, even if they didn't succeed, Congress might have stood better in the eyes of the country. Would you accept that?
Yes, I think Congress has been its worst enemy in terms of storytelling. If you look at it, the Congress narrative is very weak, apologetic, almost schizophrenic.
But you're absolutely sure there is a story to tell and a good one.
Absolutely.
Ravi Shankar Prasad, anyone can find faults with a government that's lasted for 10 years. But I want to put this to you. Can you deny the critical fact that the UPA has lifted 140 million people out of poverty, which means that India today is both a richer and a happier country than the country you left behind a decade ago?
Well, let me begin with that. On what basis? Tendulkar Commission report, Saxena Commission report, Planning Commission report, or Sen Gupta Committee report about poverty?
Can I answer that question?
Or that shameful affidavit of... Now, please, if you ask me a question, you don't allow me to reply, then don't call me.
No.
I'm replying to you. I'm raising a question. I've written the charge sheet. Or the shameful affidavit of the Supreme Court that those who spend 26 rupees in a rural area or 32 in an urban area are the poor. State governments, after state government, have challenged it. Therefore, that is a highly debatable question when there is no proper objective yardstick as far as measurement of poverty is concerned.
Can I just come in there? You see, the yardstick by which poverty is judged actually was a yardstick that goes back way beyond 2004. The figures and the facts were lower in your time in office. The figures have been raised now. But the method of judging poverty is the same. It's just that the figures have gone up. So when you question the yardstick, you're going to end up also questioning measurements that were taken of poverty when you were in power. That's why this is a very dubious, double-edged reply.
I'm sorry. I completely differ with you. The government itself is saying they're going to revisit. That is their assurance in the parliament, in our presence.
All right.
A written reply. But let's go beyond that. Come on, basic economics. They said in 100 days they will contain inflation. What is the position? Renuka ji talked of employment. Sorry, Renuka ji, I have got the 66th and 68th sample survey report, which shows employment is down. Mr. Chidambaram said unemployment has come down. Sorry, the latest sample survey even ignores manufacturing is down.
Just a moment.
Sector is down.
Ravi Shankar. Ravi Shankar Prasad. Let's.
Yet you are saying economic story is going. I'm sorry.
Ravi Shankar Prasad. Let's take.
On your documents, on your facts, which I have quoted in the charge sheet.
Ravi Shankar Prasad, let's take the economy step by step so that labor who don't have the facts accessible as you do can follow it more easily. Renuka, let's start, Mrs. Chaudhary, with the economy. Can you deny that in 2004 you inherited an economy growing at 8.5%? 10 years later, you are leaving behind an economy that is struggling to achieve even 4.9%. And industrialists and economists blame you mainly for that slowdown. Are you prepared today to accept that the biggest share of blame lies with the handling of the economy by your government?
I would say that it is but for natural to put the blame on someone there. But you have to also consider what happened internationally. So-called advanced economies as the US and the Euro, you saw what happened there, and none of them had the audacity or the courage to turn a probability into a possibility. With them, they managed to sink the rest of the world at that point. India remained buoyant. Not only that, when Greece was turning rogue on the euro front, it was India that assured its citizens, and we still invested in the social sector.
All right.
We did not cut back on education or healthcare like Japan did. And the whole of Europe did.
Okay.
And all cut back on all of this, and we didn't. We continued to invest in people And that is why today you have the youngest nation here and we export intelligence.
Let's keep the rhetoric to a minimum. Let's stick to facts, because charge sheets are a fact, not a rhetoric. Ravi Shankar Prasad, we're talking about economic growth. There's no doubt that you left behind 8.5%. You could be inheriting something close to 4.9%. But actually, a far better way of judging economic performance is to take the average growth. And the average growth for the 6 years that the NDA was in power is just 5.9%. The average growth for the 8 years after 2004 is 7.5%. So in terms of that, which is a more reliable indicator, the figures and the facts tilt against you, not in your favor.
Well, Karan, my reply is this. Let me take Renuka Chaudhary's, my good friend, point. She talked of global factors. When Mr. Bajpayee came to power in 98, we had the growth rate of 4.3%. We had the Kargil war, we had the international sanction because of Pokhran 2, we had the East Asian economic crisis, we had the 2002 great drought in the country, and the big earthquake in Gujarat. Did we talk of international reasons? No. We delivered, we performed, and left a robust 8.5% growth rate.
Just a moment. Yes, but your average is 1.5% lower. That's what you're ignoring. Your average is
1.5% lower. Karan, the point is, your simile reminds me of a boy who failed in his matriculation examination. When his father asked him, he said, my average of 6 and 7 is very much better. Come on, don't make that argument.
Well, it's a very credible argument.
8.5% growth rate, which Chidambaram himself appreciated.
All right.
In robust term, the highest in 30 years. They squandered in the coming 2, 3, 4 years that the Indians are not investing in India, forget foreign.
All right.
Themselves, because of policy paralysis.
Ravi Shankar Prasad, once again, now you're doing what Renuka did, which is to go into rhetoric. I want to stick to facts. I want to bring in Mihir Sharma. He works for the Business Standard. He follows the economy closely. As someone who understands economics, who in your eyes has handled the economy better? NDA over the 6 years they were in power, or UPA over the 10 years that are ending?
I think that one first has to split UPA 1 and UPA 2. I think UPA 2 suffered from an inability to take a lot of decisions that UPA 1 did not. Overall, the numbers suggest that on several important parameters, the fiscal deficit, for example, the UPA outperformed the NDA. But the crucial difference, the headline number that we always look at, is overall GDP growth. And what neither the UPA nor the NDA is willing to admit is that they actually have very little control over this number. This is something that, in fact, is produced by how much foreign money and how much foreign investment comes in.
Simplify your answer for the audience. Who performed better? And I know it's a trick question, but who performed better?
I think that, given the circumstances, the UPA performed as well as the NDA would have under similar circumstances.
Oh God, you're a diplomat. You're definitely not a journalist. You're not going to stick your neck out.
Neither of them was capable of fixing the problem.
All right, I'm not a diplomat. I'm just a journalist, and I'm going to stick my neck out, and I'm going to start with you, Renuka Chaudhary. Let's come to specifics. NSSO figures show that during the 6 years the NDA was in power, it created 60 million jobs, compared to, and wait for this, just 15 million during the 8 years ending 2012. Since jobs is the one thing that matters perhaps most of all to people, don't you think you've failed?
No, I don't think so at all. You have to understand what are the population differences when you talk about percentages and averages. There is
population,
a burgeoning population that happened in after the NDA. And if you look at what we have achieved...
Do you really mean that? I have to interrupt you. Are you really saying that the growth in the Indian population is responsible for the far, far, far fewer number of jobs created when you were in power? Because if that's your explanation, it is bringing smiles of enjoyment to my colleagues in the studio.
Can I please finish what I started out to say? Am I allowed to finish what I started out to say? You have to realize, I don't know how the you people figure this, but I want to tell you, world-class industry, universities, hospitals...
Come back to jobs,
..came
actually.
Into India.
Come back to jobs.
They're all job creators.
But then why haven't the jobs been created?
Sector,
but if they're job creators, why did you only create 15 million compared to 60 million in 4 years less?
because we are also alleviating poverty, and we have taken how many crore people off from the poverty line, and they just.
I mean, you can't do the two things together. You can either take people out of poverty
India.
Or create jobs, but you can't do both together.
We've done both.
All right. I can see
we
Ravi Shankar is
both.
Enjoying this.
Maybe
Mr. Prasad,
satisfy you.
Let me put something.
We have done both.
Mr. Prasad, let me put something that could perhaps lessen the smile of happiness on your face. Jairam Ramesh says that the NSSO figures are actually misleading. Instead, he points out that under the NDA, the rate of unemployment, and that's a very important thing, the rate of unemployment grew from 7.3 in 1999 to 8.3 in 2005. Under the UPA, over the next 8 years, it actually came down substantially to just 5.6. Now, unemployment is what really hurts people. And under you, unemployment grew.
Mr. Karan Thapar, Rav Ramesh is speaking on what authority? National Sample Survey is
the
only recognized instrument
are.
To measure this. Renuka, I did not disturb you. Please have patience. I'm happy to see you on television after a long time. Kindly wait for your term. Karan Thapar, this is the point I'm trying to highlight. National Sample Survey is the only instrument available. Mr. Jairam Ramesh is not disclosing what instrument he is using. The same Mr. Chidambaram said, and the latest sample survey contradicts that. That's the point. Whosoever points the error becomes suspect from CAG to sample survey also. Therefore, I am only quoting the recognized. Forget that. The Planning Commission document 13 December and November for the use of Deputy Chairman of Planning Commission contains the same data.
Before I go to Mr. Vishwanath, let me bring in Mihir Sharma, who is nodding his head because he wants to speak. Of the two surveys, the NSSO and the facts presented by Jairam Ramesh, which actually are an analysis by the Institute of Applied Manpower Research and the Planning Commission. Of the two, which is more credible, which is more reliable?
They're both true. And the reason that they're both true is that what you saw under the UPA was a great deal of increasing prosperity. You saw more people going into schools. You saw a large number of people leaving the workforce, choosing to leave the workforce because they did not. There was no distress employment anymore. A large number of women who chose not to work because their families increased in income. A large number of young people stayed in school. So you saw fewer schools, and that means that both those figures are in fact true.
So in other words, this is a situation of 50-50.
No, this is on this actually the UPA wins.
The UPA wins?
Yes.
Hands down?
Hands down.
Shri Vishwanathan, let's move beyond this controversy to do with jobs. I want to put to you some of the economic facts proclaimed by the Congress Party in its manifesto, which was released just a couple of weeks ago. First, they say food production is 263 million tons compared to 213 10 years ago. Second, installed park capacity is 234,600 megawatts compared to just 112,700 megawatts 10 years ago. Third, they claim we have 95 crore mobile subscribers compared to just 3.36 crore 10 years ago. Spending on health, they say, is increased 5 times, spending on education nearly 8 times. All of that put together, does that tilt the argument in Congress's favor? Or as a sociologist who tracks all of this, do you think they are picking selective facts to make themselves look better whilst ignoring others that would be embarrassing?
Look, I must warn you about two things. First, numbers. You know, you can just bring another high priest from economics who will challenge both of us and look equally convincing.
I mean, this is lies, damned lies and statistics.
No, there's statistics, statistics and statistics. It's the way you interpret it which defines the nature of the lie and the truth. But more important, I think what you've got to look at is silences. I think we're not looking at certain things. I think one of the first things you've got to ask is, not with the agricultural productivity went up, why did so many farmers commit suicide? You have to look at the sociological consequences of a set of numbers. I don't think we're doing that. Let's take something. The question you've got to ask is not how much you spent on health, but how expensive health is today. The question you've got to ask about education is, apart from primary education, what is the quality of education you're going? Quality doesn't seem to enter into this at all.
So the silences are the damning thing, and would those silences be there on both sides, or
yes.
Is it only on the Congress side?
No,
both.
I think there are silences on both sides. This is the worrying part of the narrative.
Very quickly, because time, as usual, is always our enemy, I want to come to the political accusations made by the BJP against you, Renuka Chaudhary, I mean by your opponents against your government. First of all, they say that Dr. Manmohan Singh worked more like a CEO of a company where the board was headed by Srimati Sonia Gandhi with Rahul Gandhi as her deputy. The conclusion they reach is the office of Prime Minister was devalued, its integrity compromised, governance as a result suffered seriously. How do you defend Dr. Manmohan Singh, the face and image of your government?
I think it's such a pity that the BJP doesn't understand decency or reticence or restraint.
You mean it's indecent to be critical
they
of the Prime Minister?
Full of embarrassment. No. They have been critical of the Prime Minister. They have been disrespectful of a Prime Minister.
But are they correct and accurate in the criticism?
They do not want to admit. No, I'm sorry. They're not.
So this criticism is wrong?
We've had the Prime Minister. Yes, it is wrong.
Let me quickly stop you, because I want to point out to Ravi Shankar Prasad that when you level this criticism at Dr. Manmohan Singh, there's a classic case of the pot coiling the kettle black, because the truth is Atal Bihari Vajpayee, who you revere, was actually a hands-off Prime Minister. He wasn't a man of detail. Rajesh Mishra took most of the decisions. Vajpayee usually spent the afternoon resting. So if you could accept that and still revere him as Prime Minister, why are you so worried about Dr. Manmohan Singh being a CEO? And remember, the number of things the RSS didn't let Vajpayee do. As far as the RSS were concerned, he was a CEO for them.
I'm really surprised and shocked to hear the eminent journalist Karan Thapar comparing Vajpayee with Manmohan Singh, a mass leader. The last word, I have worked in his cabinet. And I know Karan Thapar, in the heart of your heart, you don't believe it.
I'm talking about how he functioned as PM, not his oratory or his leadership.
Please allow me to complete. I'm sorry to say that Mr. Vajpayee was the final word, was a mass leader elected by the people of India as the Prime Minister. And you are doing great disservice to the image of that man by comparing him to Dr. Manmohan Singh, who could not even muster the courage.
Suddenly sounding unjustifiably popular.
Please give me 1 minute, Karan Thapar. Please give me 1 minute. It's very unfair you don't allow to speak. Madam Renuka Chaudhary said that we have been disrespectful. Renuka Chaudhary, when he was in America, your great leader Rahul Gandhi tore away the ordinance and snubbed him publicly that it is nonsense. Was he respectful towards Dr. Manmohan Singh? And we have the case of a foreign secretary, Venkateshwaran, in 87,
okay,
who being publicly snubbed by Rajiv Gandhi, chose to resign. He had 3 years service left. When Dr. Manmohan Singh was in America, Rahul Gandhi said his ordinance approved by his cabinet is a nonsense.
Yes, but how does that answer the question I raised about Atal Bihari Vajpayee? I mean, you're evading it by simply raising charges about the other party. Let me.
I'm only saying Manmohan Singh's office has been devalued by his ministers.
You know, inevitably this was going to become a tutu meme between the two of you. I was hoping I could keep it more structured. I'm going to cut out of your tutu meme and give literally a one-word answer opportunity to my studio guests. Same question to both of you. Keep it really short. First, Mr. Vishwanath, who of the two will go down in history as the better Prime Minister, Vajpayee or Manmohan Singh?
Depends on what the scale is. I think this comparison of these two, as if they're similar entities, is false. Look, let's be very clear about one thing. They were two different imaginations.
All right.
And if you don't understand the power of two different imaginations, you're being unfair to both.
I'm going to stop you there, because what you're saying is virtually impossible to judge who was better.
No, you can judge, but you've got to specify the criteria. Now, if you specify the criteria, the things turn out to be different. See, you don't have to.
I'm out of time, so you have to be very short and sharp. Who will India think did more for the country in terms of development? A quick yes or no on one or other.
Manmohan Singh.
That's your answer. Manmohan Singh.
Yes.
Better than Vajpayee. Your answer?
Manmohan Singh. I think that this idea that somehow if somebody's CEO, it's a bad thing, shows a sort of innate anti-business approach.
But there's a business and journalist speaking. Clearly preferring a CEO to a Prime Minister, but I'm going to end my show over there. My two independent experts have said Manmohan Singh. I can see that Ravi Shankar Prasad is clearly upset. He's talking, and Renuka, for once, probably for the first time, is smiling. And we've run right out of time. My thanks to all four of my guests for joining me. And if you have been, thanks for watching. Goodbye.
good night.